to start with some expressions of gratitude of my own. First of all, to the Ribbono Shel Olam that I'm standing here, because I went through 5 days of terrific flu. 2 days ago, I was flat. If this had been yesterday, I would have had the cancer. I'm just barely standing up, for which I'm very grateful. I prefer to stand, and it gives more energy, but I just want to express my gratitude to Kodesh Baruch Hu. Second of all, to Family Haas, who on their own initiative and their own support and their own organization and professionalism and direction and commitment to the from the beginning to the end was absolutely phenomenal. I had nothing to do but say thank you over and over again. And really extremely, extremely grateful, both for the event itself and also for the fact that it represents that people are actually receiving a benefit from what I do, which is my hope, my prayer, that I'm able to do that. My subject is reason to believe. I want to take a few minutes to perhaps defuse an uphill battle. For some people, the very idea of having reason to believe is at best superfluous, and if not that, then dangerous. What about emuna pshuta? I believe it because it inspires me, because it thrills me, because it puts me in tune with the universe. I believe it because I received it from my parents, from my grandparents, from my teachers. We have a Masorah. Why isn't that the preferred way for a Jew to face the world and to face the Ribbono Shel Olam? It's a big subject. It requires a lot of background. I want to acquaint you with a few sources, which not everyone is aware of, just to show you that there's more to be thought about. The Rambam famously begins the Mishnah Torah with Yisod HaYisodos V'Amud HaChochmos Leida Sheyesh Sham Matsui Rishon. The foundation of foundations and the pillar of all wisdoms is to know that there is a first being who brings everything else into being. Knowledge is not emunah pshuta. Knowledge is belief with reason. Some of you are aware that in the Sefer HaMitzvos, the translation is that it's a mitzvah la'amin, which means a mitzvah to believe. That is true. Although Rav Heller from before the war and Rav Kapach now both say that that's a mistranslation, and the Sefer HaMitzvot should also be translated Leida. And if you don't accept the emendation, then since the Mishnah Torah is written later than the Sefer HaMitzvot, that becomes his received view. That's a mitzvah to know. The Ramchal, whose Derech Hashem, Perek Aleph, is based on Yisodia Torah, content and in style, makes no ambiguity. He says, "Kol yidit sarich lahamin v'leida." So obviously, leida goes beyond lahamin. It means also to know. Then there's Marsho in Brachos. More Brachos that you design. Says Margalo Puud Rav Meir, there was a pearl in Rav Meir's mouth. Gemor b'chol avav chol v'chol nafsh chol adas es drachai. Study with all your heart, with all your soul, to know my ways. V'lishko gal dal se sorosi, to plant yourself on the doors of my Torah. T'tzor torosi b'limcho, guard my Torah in your heart. V'negen enecho t'yeh yorosi, my awe or fear should be before your eyes. Shmor p'icho mikol chait, preserve your mouth from all sin. Preserve yourself and purify yourself from all guilt. And I'll be with you in every place. That could go on any Musa Yeshiva. Or indeed, the house of any Jew who wants to be a good Jew. I don't believe there's anyone, if you haven't seen it, have a clue what the Marsho says about those words. Marsho says, Gemor b'chol avavcho, hakavona b'zeh the intention of this statement, Kamo shekosvu ha-pilosofim ho-elokihim, is as the godly philosophers wrote. I think that's the right translation. Maybe it's the philosophers of godliness, but more likely, pilosofim ha-elokihim. The chayiv kol adam lahaskil, b'yediyas mitziyuso, b'achduso, b'yecholto, b'yediyas drachov. Every person has an obligation to understand. Laskil means intellectually, sekeldik, his God's existence and his unity, and know his ways. Kamo yad sikhlo shel adam, of course, according up to your intellectual abilities. Achalpi emunaseinu, of course, everything has to be guided by our emuna, v'toraseinu. V'chol ma'ashen irlo, v'sichlo, shehu neged toraseinu v'kadosha, anything in his researches which seems to be against what he's received as what the Torah says. Lo yamin, but we should not trust it. V'yisle adob v'kat sichlo, we should attribute it to the weakness of his intellect. Zesh omer rabbi meir, gemor b'chol avavcha, but da'as drachai, you should know my ways, ki ashebimenu timtza mofes, from my ways you'll find a proof, limitziyoso, mitziyuso, v'achduso, v'yiroso, v'yecholto, to his existence and his unity and his power, shehuvadai dovor godol, ki gamze Moshe ha'ish, ha'ish Moshe, Moshe Rabbeinu b'kesh al zeh. Moshe Rabbeinu wanted to have proofs of all these principles of emunah. Where did he want that? When he said, "Homeini knows Torah," that's what he was asking for. Ach, ashetishkod al dalsi torosi, plant yourself in the doors of my Torah. Be sure this is under constant correction, and so on. So Moshe is saying that this kind of intellectual analysis and arrival at intellectual understanding and proof is something that is at least appropriate that call you, everyone, should do. Final example I have to share with you is the Shlach HaKadosh. In the introduction to Ma'am HaRishon of Yisrael Monroes, he says the following, Shorosh HaShoroshim, Shorosh HaDvorim, who Shorosh HaRoshim, the root of all things is the root of all roots. You should know this day and put it upon your heart that Hashem is God. Rot Silomar, Yediyas, Yediya, Belay, Bahasoga, Muftis. It's understanding in the heart, knowledge in the heart, with proof. An understanding based on proof. Nosaf al HaKabbalah Mitzad Avoso. In addition to what he was mekabel, in addition to the Masorah that he received from his parents and ancestors, Zemurum is Masha Omer Da'as Elokei Avicha. Know the God of your father. You've heard of the God of your father. You know him from your father. You have a tradition from your father. It's not enough. You have to know him. Otzolaman Nosaf Omer Asher Hukba Emunas Elokus Belibo Belibcho Mitzad Avicha Da'ino Akabola Ish Biish. In addition to what you receive, you have to know it by your own understanding. I suggest to you that the Rambam and the Ramchal and the Mashah and the Shloh, who then goes on to quote the Chovos Lavavos, so you can add the Chovos Lavavos as well, these are not outlying positions, they're not discarded opinions. These are mainstream to the Masorah, and even though you might find those who hold differently, but it's certainly something which is represented within the Masorah, Haimitis of the Torah, something worthwhile doing. And this is the goal to which I have tried to make a contribution. I started this project 45 years ago, when I started to become frum. Well, now I'm exaggerating, it's 48 years ago or more. And I faced these battles because I came from a non-frum family altogether. And I was at Brandeis University, where there was almost no one there who Jeff Bezos. And I was subject to every kind of challenge, every kind of pressure, every kind of attack, every kind of contradiction. And I pride myself in being an open-minded person, and I want to know the truth. And therefore, I can't just duck my head in the sand. I have to face the problems that come up. Now, the problems come up, you're divided into two camps. There are objections from external sources, external disciplines, like physics, like cosmology, like chemistry, like psychology, if there were such a subject. I didn't say that. Or like biblical criticism, and so on. Many, many people have written on those subjects. I think they've done a wonderful job. Even though I have snippets here and there, which I've contributed because of my particular background, I don't think those are ones that need my help. Though the other side is, where's the positive evidence on your own side? Not just answering other people's objections, not just showing the weakness in other people's attacks, but where's the positive evidence that your position is true? What does it rely on? And that's where I've expended the majority of my efforts. The book's divided into 8 chapters. It's 4 short chapters, and then the same 4 chapters over again, much longer. The first 4 are about 70 pages in total, written that any high school graduate who can pay attention, can read and believe and understand, argument laid out in simple, clear, precise enough, but simple and clear detail, so that you get the gist of the argument. The next 230 pages are a repeat of each chapter in much greater detail, long footnotes, some of the footnotes are more than a page long, where I answer the kinds of technical objections that people have raised over the years. I've been teaching this material for 40 years, and it has accumulated a lot of attention and a lot of attack, and I've spent a lot of time answering these people. Much of it is already up in the website, and much of it is not. Some of it first came out in the book. The chapter is divided into 4 subjects, and I'll describe them briefly to you, and I'll take you through one of them in a little bit of detail. First of all, if you're going to claim you have reason to believe anything, you have to try to decide how much support you need, how much evidence you need, how much in favor of you have to present to say you have enough to call it reason. It'd be no good to say, I have reason, he says you don't, and I present 62, and he says, 62, that's nothing. Till you get to 81, it's nothing. Then you didn't accomplish anything. We've got to agree on how much has to be presented in order to call it reason. I answer that question by saying, this is crucial. What I'm telling you now is crucial in all of life. There's no such thing as proof. Don't ever accept the challenge to give a proof. If someone asks you, prove it, say, no thank you, have a nice day. I'm not in that business. I want to give you adequate reason to accept it as true. Proof is another story altogether. You know what they say in an American court, if it's a criminal court, you have to provide proof beyond a reasonable doubt. Now imagine if somebody who said, what are you talking about? It's going to go to jail. You might die. I want proof beyond all possible doubt. That's impossible. Possible doubt? It's possible to doubt anything. Maybe you're misremembering. Maybe you're temporarily insane. Once you invite the imagination to think of alternatives, the sky's the limit. Do you know for sure there aren't any leprechauns? Can you prove there are no leprechauns? No. You're out, because maybe it was a leprechaun. See, that's a doubt. It's a doubt, but it's not a reasonable doubt. What we want is to have enough reason to believe. It's enough reason if you have proof beyond a reasonable doubt. Anything beyond that's not reasonable. So what you want is not proof per se, but you want enough reason to say Given this amount of reason, and here's the crucial move, given this amount of reason, if you want to oppose me, show me positive reason against me. Don't just sit in your armchair, cross your arms, close your eyes, and say, I'll bet it was E.T. I'll bet it was pixies from under the rug. Just using your imagination, that's not good enough. You want to oppose my position? Open up your eyes. I would have said go to the library, but that dates me. And find positive information against me. I'm presenting information in favor. You present information against, let's weigh it up and see who has the best information. Then we can make an assessment. But just thinking that I might possibly be wrong, when someone asks whether you might not possibly be wrong, just say yes and go on. Of course I could be possibly wrong. Couldn't it be? Yeah, could be. It could be, but so what? We don't live our lives on possibilities. We live our lives on probabilities. I'm showing you a probability. You want to oppose me? Show me a greater probability from somewhere else. So I claim we have enough evidence to put the probability on our side in competition with any other reasonable position. That's the claim that I make. That's adequate reason to believe. One section deals with truth. I'm not going to talk to you about that because you're all convinced that the truth is important. You're not postmoderns who don't understand their own position anyway. And if somebody's really worried about that, ask me in the question period and I'll tell you about it. The other two sections present in great detail two areas of evidence. One is from Jewish history, the survival of the Jewish people. I believe that the survival of the Jewish people cannot be explained in any natural terms because people have been trying for hundreds of years and the explanations fail spectacularly, and because the phenomenon doesn't get weaker, the phenomenon gets stronger and it changes through time. The closest thing to a controlled experiment in history is the survival of the Jewish people. We are surviving through more different conditions than any other culture and still survive. So someone's going to come up with an explanation that covers all the bases in a common way, since the ones that have been tried have failed, and it's been a long time trying. Now the holdout says, but listen, science is making so much progress. Surely eventually we should assume that science will solve this problem too. Well, the answer is no, we should not. First of all, because science isn't making nearly the progress that people tell you about, because they only tell you about the good side. They don't tell you about the bad side. They don't tell you about the things that got unexplained, the things that were simple and became complicated. You know, 120 years ago, cells were just vesicles of jelly. There was no interesting structure in a cell. It was just jelly held together, and a lot of them held together into a gelatinous body. And that was the entire picture of how you being, how an animal lives. Did that turn out to be right? Do we understand the cell today? With 10,000 different nanomachines working in each cell, and discovering new ones all the time, and new interactions all the time, and new functions all the time. Did that continue to be as simple as is expected? What about the existence of the universe? Till 1965, they could kid themselves that the universe had no beginning. That's simple, that's easy. Then you don't ask where it came from because it was always here. What's it always been doing? What it's been doing now? It's always been doing the same thing. And that disappeared from under their feet. And now you have the Big Bang and there's a gigantic amount of controversy about that. So from being uniform and accepted and easy to understand, it went to being controversial, difficult, and then you have string theory, which one physicist writes, it's not even science. So things are not moving in the direction where everything's getting explained and more gaps are being closed. New gaps are opening up all the time. Secondly, the social sciences. Nothing like that is going on. We're talking about explaining Jewish survival. Jewish survival is not why stars explode. Thirdly, in science itself, not always do they take that attitude. Sometimes in science, they themselves make up their minds. We need a revolution. We're not going to wait for new way to explain that will save all the old rules and save the old picture. When they discovered all the neutrons together in the nucleus, bad news, because they're all positively charged. And like charges repel. So every one of those neutrons is telling all the other neutrons, get out of here. And they're sitting, snuggling, packed together in the nucleus. Why are they doing that? Gravity? Gravity is orders of magnitude too low. Did they say, let's wait a century and see whether we'll figure out a way to explain it? No, they said we discovered a new force. The old picture's wrong. We've got to change the old picture and put something new in. Because sometimes you can't do that. Sometimes you make a decision. The basis of the phenomenon that you're studying and the resources in your scientific bag of tricks, you decide it's not the time to do this. At any rate, I claim that there's no remotely plausible explanation for survival, and I do in an appendix now. The book is 100,000 words. That was my limit. I had another 50,000 words. I put them up as appendices on my website. And I have a long appendix on surveying Jewish historians. You can get that for nothing. So you don't even have to buy the book. If you're interested in Jewish historians, just go to the website and read that. Jacob Neusner, for example, go through some of his books and some of his descriptions, and some of you are old enough to remember Jacob. That's roughly the treatment that I give to Jewish history. The heart of what I'm doing, the one that's attracted the most attention and vituperation and condemnation and attack and all those other nice things, is my work on Sinai. The evidence that the description of the revelation at Sinai is a true historical event, not just a myth. Ancient religions, some modern religions, some modern ideologies are based on myths. And some people want to say that there's no reason not to think that this is also a myth to glorify our ancestors or whatever. I want to present evidence that it's a real story, that's a story about a real event. And again, evidence, reason to believe. This is called on the net the Kuzari principle, because that's where I took the inspiration from, Sefer Kuzari, though I took the principle from him, but then I give it an ibud, as you say in Hebrew. I worked it out in modern terms, so it would be able to address the kinds of concerns that people would have at the moment. Let me explain to you what the principle is and what it does, and then I'll show you some of the ways in which people try to attack it, how to handle them, and then I'll stop for questions. There are traditions, people, families, clans, religious groups, nations have traditions. Typically the traditions about some historical event or another, or some historical trend, or some historical feature. Some of the traditions are about events that happen to individuals. Some are about events that happen to armies. A lot of stories about wars, travelers, people who discovered new continents or new areas, sports heroes, politicians. We have lots of traditions. Most cases, a nation has traditions about its own history. Sometimes one nation has traditions about another nation's history as well. But most of the traditions are internal, nationally. A nation has traditions about its own history. I'm interested in a narrow subclass, a particular subclass of these traditions. I want a national tradition that describes a national experience. Not every national tradition describes a national experience. Sometimes a national tradition describes the experience of an individual, or the experience of a small group, expeditionary group, or military group, or the political machinations that led to the compromise that saved the government, and so forth and so on. I'm talking about national traditions about national experiences. For example, a national tradition that says 300 years ago, we fought a war, and we were invaded, and the enemy slashed and burned, and We took terrible losses, and we were dominated by the enemy for 20 years, and then we had a local rebellion, and we kicked them out. That's a national experiential tradition, or the tradition of invention of music technology. 450 years ago, one of our people discovered the idea of having two wheels in the back and one wheel in the front. Had never been heard of anywhere else than we knew. And he made a new type of vehicle, and soon everybody was copying it. Within 20 years, everybody in the country had it, and we were the only ones that had it. We used it in war, we were successful, and technological invention that arose and became popular and spread throughout the group. Or disease, like the Black Death in Europe, where in 10 years, 30% of Europe died. Everybody knew everybody was dying. You didn't need a historian 100 years later to write to find out that people elsewhere were dying. That was something which everybody knew was happening to everybody at the same time. Or migration. Search of better pastures. Our whole nation, 452,000 people, picked up from this valley and walked 25 miles and moved to that valley. That's how we got to this valley. These are national experiential traditions. Again, it's got to be a national tradition. By that I mean, at least at some time, for some time, everyone in the nation believes it. Everyone except the fringes who don't believe anything. Nothing can be everybody. And it's got to be a description of a national experience, not what happened to an individual or a group or what they're told by another group. And it ought to be the kind of thing which, when it happens to a nation, you would expect people to mark it, people to remember it, to preserve the memory of it. Not every national experience has that character. Solar eclipses are visible everywhere in the world from time to time. Almost no ancient cultures kept records. Why? Because, as you know very well, the solar eclipse to them came as a shock, a surprise, perhaps frightening. But once it went away, everything went back to normal. Cows didn't start giving birth to two-headed calves, and the king didn't die, and it's just things carried on as before. Okay, so it's weird, can't explain it, it's unexpected and frightening, and have a good day. Back to milk production. So they didn't make records of things like that. I'm talking about a national tradition, about national experiences, that would have changed the life of the nation. I want to know, how many of those national traditions are known to be false? Anywhere in the world. For the logicians, I'm not using Torah to prove Torah. I've stepped entirely outside of Torah now. I've stepped entirely outside. I want to know about Egyptian traditions, Chinese traditions, South Seas traditions, South American traditions, Alaskan traditions, human traditions all over the world. I want to know how many traditions like this are false. A good place to find these is in myths. I don't know how many have heard, I hope nobody, of Bullfinch's mythology. 780 pages of ancient myths. So I went through it page by page. I'm looking for one, just one. We'll have a nation which will have a tradition about its whole past, at some point in its past, its whole population, having an experience which you would expect to have an impact on the life of the nation. Not one. Indeed, in the whole book, there are only two cases where nation A has a tradition about, a national tradition about a historical event, and in both cases, it's nation A that has a tradition about what happened to nation B. But no nation has a tradition about its own national experience, which is known to be false. Many have traditions that are believed to be true about wars, about migrations, about technological events, and the rest, as I gave examples. But not a single one that's known to be false. Not one. I think that's surprising. The ancient world was a world full of myth. Myth was something which was woven into their very lives. Not only that, but this is something which people lose sight of. Don't forget the ancient peoples were surrounded by the supernatural all the time. The sun shining is supernatural. The rain's falling is supernatural. It comes when you pray for it, if you pray for it right. Life and death, fertility, success at war. And you lived in the Nile Valley. The Nile's overflowing. Every spring is the Nile God giving you prosperity. They were surrounded by miracles all the time. They didn't have trouble with miracles. That's one of the reasons that they didn't become Jewish when they saw the Makos. So your God does miracles. Our God's been doing miracles for thousands of years. Thank you very much. So the picture of a tradition, national tradition, if it's easy to make up traditions like this, why don't you have among all the myths of the world anywhere a single example of this kind of myth? Now, of course, I've had this on the web for over 8 years, and now, if I had thought of it, now they call it crowdsourcing, because when I put it up, I definitely stepped on a lot of people's toes. So I started getting a lot of emails, you know, you didn't see this, you're missing that, all these kind of, and the blogs are full of accounting. So I went through them one by one, and usually there is gross inattention to detail. For example, there's a Native American tribe which has a record of a national revelation. So the writer said to me, what more can you want than that? He's got your story, a national revelation. You don't believe him, you don't think he's right, and yet he has your story, so that proves that you can make up myths like this. So I set up one of my Talmidim to working on it. He came back and said, oh yes, they have a story of a national revelation. Here's how it goes. This is tribe A. Tribe A's story is that tribe B had the revelation, and then they all died. Every one of them, all gone. And the priest of tribe A told tribe A about tribe B's national revelation. Got it? That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is where your nation has a tradition about your nation's history, not some other nation's history. The critic had just sort of missed that part. the beliefs of people who are susceptible to loose thinking and to prejudice often are confused with the principle that we're talking about. What about the anti-Semites? Don't they believe things about Jews which are equivalent to this kind of tradition? Well, first of all, if they believe it about Jews, then it isn't a nation believing it about its own ancestry. So that's not what we're talking about. But more than that, take blood libels. Blood libels were beyond count. What was the story of a blood libel? Did they ever say that at noon, the Jews came en masse down to the marketplace, overwhelmed the 2,000 Christians who were there, because there were 5,000 Jews, and took off a screaming Christian child against his will, and then used him for his blood for the Nazis? There isn't a single story like that. Why not? These are crazy people, they're biased people, they're vicious people. Why did they make up that story? This isn't even national. It's just a large story about the population of a town. Because you can't get that story off the ground. Because people aren't going to believe something like that that happened to the whole town without anybody noticing it until you told us about it. No, the Christian child goes missing privately, nobody knows what happened to him, and then you spin the story about it that he was taken by the Jews. That's the explanation, something you didn't see. The anti-Semites, all their stories are like that. Jews control international news and international banks. Why? Because every year at the Waldorf Astoria, the Jews get together and have a public meeting where they invite the press and explain, we're going to do this to the Wall Street Journal, we're going to do that to Chase Manhattan and the rest. No, it's all behind closed doors where nobody's looking. It's all hidden. Because then you can make up the story because you're not talking about something that should have been public knowledge. At any rate, this is the fact. The fact is that there aren't known false, what I call NETs, national experiential traditions. Now let's apply it. What is the tradition about Sinai? The tradition about Sinai which was believed unanimously for 3,000 years. Until 300 years ago, it was believed unanimously. How do I know it's unanimous? Because our tradition preserves many rebellions, both in the Tanakh and in the Gemara and in the Medrash, many rebellions of many different kinds. You don't have a single mention anywhere of there never having been a revelation. No, that's never part of any rebellion. So this particular tradition was kept unanimously for 3,000 years. Now, what kind of tradition is it? Well, it definitely describes a national experience. It says every man, woman, child heard God speak. If you're under the impression that Moshe got words on a mountain, came down and told the people, go back and read the Chumash, at least in six places. Twice in Shmos and four times in Dvorim, it says you heard God's voice speaking to you, men HaShamayim. And this is not the sort of thing you expect people to forget in the evening soccer scores. This is a big event. In particular, it ordains a weekly holiday. Things are going to be different right away, every week. So this is definitely a national experiential tradition. So the argument now goes like this. Many people make many sorts of mistakes. It doesn't follow that everyone or anyone will make every kind of mistake. That doesn't follow. Open your eyes and take a look. Do an investigation and see whether or not it's true that these types of traditions ever fail. If you find, in fact, in human experience, that these traditions don't fail, then you have very strong evidence that these traditions are true even when you can't check. That's how you do sampling. That's how you check things about the past that you can't check. Check other things that are relatively similar, gather statistics, and then apply the rule. That's what you get here. You get an absolutely perfect set of data that no such thing has ever happened. Now I'm going to take 3 minutes to express the thought that's probably rattling around in many people's minds and show you how to answer it, and then I'm going to quit. Rabbi, I don't believe you. I just don't believe you. You're telling me that these traditions can't go wrong? It's easy to imagine how they could go wrong. It's easy. Look, the king wants to change the history of the people. So he kills out all the history teachers. He puts his soldiers in as teachers for the children. And the children are all taught the history that he tells the soldiers to teach them. And of course, they all grow up believing a new history. Or the priests use mescaline, and the people are in a frenzy. And when they're high, he tells them things which they come to believe. Or more realistically, something which the anthropologists and their great wisdom will tell you is myth formation. Some natural event happens, and people are impressed by it, shook by it, it strikes them, it focuses their attention. They tell it over generation by generation, and as they tell it over generation by generation, little by little the telling changes. They add a little bit, or they subtract a little bit, or they change in nuances. They themselves don't notice the changes, but after 20 generations, there can be a lot of changes. They accumulate, and then the story at the other end is something very different from what really happened. Why can't that happen, Rabbi? I don't see why you're so confident that that sort of thing can't happen with your traditions. And if you pay close attention and you notice my shift in vocabulary, you already know the answer. But let me tell you the answer. I would say to the critic, Sir Critic, I want to ask you a question. You're claiming you had scenarios that could produce my tradition, even if it's not true. Are you claiming that your scenarios are possible or probable? Which are you claiming? Are you saying it's possible that our tradition was produced by such a scenario? The soldiers, the priests, the myth formation, or probable? Makes a big difference, critic. Let's go through one by one. You say it's possible, I give it to you. Everything's possible. Leprechauns are possible. Goodbye. We don't live in terms of possibilities. We simply threw that out at the beginning. No, in order to make any headway, you've got to show that it's probable. Fine, says the critic. It's probable that your tradition was produced by one of my scenarios or some other similar scenarios. I say, really? Why do you say it's probable? What's your evidence that it's probable? Has any such scenario ever worked in history? Ever? in all of human history? Do you have a single example where it worked? Well, you see here, the door slammed shut because there aren't any known false traditions. So a fortiori, there can't be any cases where a scenario produced a false tradition. So you can't produce any. I think that's dead end for the critic. If you say it's possible, I give it to you, it's irrelevant. And if you say it's probable, you can't say that because you have not a single case that works. Not one. That being the case, I say we have enormous evidence, empirical evidence, evidence in terms of experience, that the tradition is a true tradition. That being the case, we have adequate reason to believe that the revelation at Sinai is a real historical event. At any rate, that's what I wanted to tell you. Thank you for listening. Let's take some questions for a little bit while, and we should stop at 9 o'clock. Yes?
Yeah, does this have any bearing on interpretation after Sinai, or you don't even go there? You know what I'm saying? A lot of people have problems. Oh, I believe it's, but I think the rabbis misinterpret, or they sort of took it in their own hands, and then a lot of problems erupted, and then they have a lot of feedback saying how things could shift over the years. You understand?
Yeah, I understand you. I understand you. Nothing I have said deals. Nothing said in the book deals with that. No, I'm starting from a person starting from nothing.
From nothing. Okay.
But I do have on my website. I have material on that. Audio material on that. I've shared them on the oral tradition, both on my website and on Torah Anytime, and also Hidabrut, in case you're not informed, but Hidabrut has opened up in English. And they have the latest, they've been filming me the latest shear in the last year and a half. So,
when you say the word traditions, yep. Do you understand, like, traditions can mean a lot of stuff? Do you understand? So I was wondering, if you just mean biblical reference to this particular scenario, which yes, that limits a lot of, it just limits a lot to, okay, it's, you know, it's a nice story, but the implications are just very...
No, I'm talking about the transmission of the tradition, how accurate it is, and how...
Of this particular tradition.
Which particular?
Meaning Sinai.
No, I'm talking now about the oral tradition, what's codified in Shas.
Codified in Shas is based on science, you could prove that? You're saying the website.
No, we have two different. I wrote a book. And part of the book that I just presented to you is the argument to take the description of the revelation at Sinai as real historical fact. End of subject one.
Okay.
New subject. Where do the Mishnayos come from? Where are the Gemaras? Where do the prizes come from? How do I know the Rabbi Ravashi told it correctly and so on and so on? How do I know they passed it on accurately over millennia and so on and so on? That's a separate subject. And I've spoken about that on my various audience. Yeah.
What are five or six classic examples of the NETs? Or did I say that right? NETs.
National
experiential traditions. What are in the world that you say are true? What are just some examples of it?
Well, the Trojan Wars and the formation of the Roman polity. And the Magna Carta, and these are traditions, the national traditions, the traditions, the nations all preserve them as traditions about their own history, and these are things which were communicated to everybody in the country because they had an effect on everybody in the country. Particularly, if you had to pay taxes, you knew there was a government in Rome. And the historians themselves in the book, I quote from historians who say this is how we know the basis of ancient history. We know from the traditions that they had.
And how do we know they weren't embellished along the way, the myth theory?
Well, there are ways in which you can criticize traditions in general. First of all, you can use archaeology. If the tradition says the battle took place in such and such a riverbed, and you dig down and you find absolutely nothing there, and you find the same thing 2 miles away, then you may have reason to think that the tradition got shifted at some point in time. If the tradition says the battle was fought with certain types of weapons and you find the remains of the battle and those weapons aren't there, then you see that a false element has been inserted into the tradition. This is what we would look for to find failures, you see? And that's what we don't find.
We don't find any of those stories.
That's right. We don't find failures of that type. So you also look to compare the traditions of two different nations, especially ones that are adjacent to one another. If one says we fought against B and one, and the other one says we fought against A and one, you have a problem. Because they didn't both win. So then, you know, then it's became propaganda, and they have to worry that maybe the traditions of this type, of this group, are somewhat propaganda. This is the way things are done. But in terms of national experiential traditions, by the way, some people ask about the Christian miracles. It's very interesting. I researched that as well, and I wrote about that. The largest number that's mentioned in their books is 5,000 people who are totally unidentified. And then another time says 3,000, and events take place in different places, and so on. They're totally unidentified, and you're talking about a heavily populated metropolitan area at the time. So 5,000 people is 5% of the population or less. So you're talking about a very small minority. You're not talking about anything resembling a national experience. Yeah?
They found fossils of dinosaurs. Have they found fossils or skeletons of the Jews in the desert?
In the middle and western United States in the 19th century, there were billions of buffalo. Millions of buffalo. You don't find any skeletons. That's 200 years ago. Not 3,000 years ago. What happened? Sometimes they disappear. It depends upon the local conditions, the local soil conditions, climatic conditions, water conditions. And when you're talking about over thousands of years, obvious that you should expect. What you need to do is, yes, find them of others, and then not find them of these. Now, if you're talking about the Sinai, here I'm just going to take a moment to expand on a logical idea. It is improper to take a book and say, well, I'm going to see whether this book is true or not. Let's see what the book says. The book says this and this miracle took place. I don't believe in miracles. Miracles are ridiculous. So if the book is talking about something real altogether, it's not a miracle. It's something else which the authors described as a miracle. But it isn't. Okay, so what could it be? A big storm. Now let's test. Let's see, was there a big storm or wasn't there a big storm? No, there was no big storm. See that? The book's got to be wrong. Excuse me, that wasn't what the book said. The book said it was a miracle. And you decided not to test that. You decided to test your naturalistic reinterpretation of it. That says nothing about the book at all. You don't want to deal with miracles, so don't deal with the book. Don't pretend you're dealing with the book. So for example, where's the mud layer from the flood? Excuse me, but natural floods leave mud layers. Miraculous floods? How many miraculous floods have you tested? What kind of surveys have you done on miraculous floods? None? So then, scientifically, it doesn't count, see? Oh, well, you always have that way out. Sure, because it's my book. And I take my book seriously. It says it's a miracle, so it's a miracle. You want to test it, figure out some other way to test it. Don't do it that way, because then you're not testing my book. This goes on all the time. So I'm not impressed. Now, you talk about the bones of the Jews. Talk about the bones of Jews in the wilderness when they're leaving Egypt. The Torah tells us that they camped in, if I'm not mistaken, 39 different places over the 40 years. One place over 19 years, and then went around place to place. Each year on Tisha B'Av, they built a gigantic pit, and they all lay down, and the people who were alive the next morning got up, and the rest were dead. So it means that some 20 places in the desert, there are pits, maybe 100 yards by 100 yards, 20 pits in the desert, maybe one of them 300 yards by 300 yards, in the whole of Sinai Desert. Did you really look? How well did you look? I just read now about something that was lost a few decades ago and was buried under 1,000 feet of sand from a few decades ago. How deep did you go? Tell me, how deep did you go to find something that was 3,300 years ago? I mean, this we didn't find is a joke. It's a joke. You don't know where to look, you don't know how to look, and when you take into account the way the story is written, you're looking isn't good. Yes?
Is it not, to explain it to somebody who's skeptical, is it not reasonable to say that for every generation that heard it from the generation before, you could be skeptical? But if you were the child or the person who was supposedly standing at Sinai among 3,000 other people, 3 million other people, why would you be convinced that that story happened if you were never, if when you were there it didn't happen? Wouldn't it be enough that this many people relate it to their families and their family? If you go to the first family, why would they, 3 million people, lie?
I think
you're
right.
It doesn't make sense.
I think you're right. If you start with the fact that 3 million people taught the next generation, their next generation, that this happened, then I think you're right. That would be inconceivable. In particular, some of the people they're teaching were there also.
Right.
The children. Not to be carried on. But the critic is going to say...
And would the writer of the book make it fewer, less people, like 200?
No. That's not the issue. The issue is this. The critic is going to say that the whole story was made up 400 years later. For 400 years, nothing happened.
Yeah, but even that first person, if you were to tell me a story that happened 50 years ago, I'd say, why didn't my father tell me about it?
But that's a different argument. That's the argument that I make.
Oh, okay.
That's the argument that I make. How are you going to start this?
Right.
So now, I just finished. This is where I started from. Your intuition was my intuition. How are you going to start this? How are you going to tell people this? They're going to ask you if it's really true, we should have known about it. Just like you said, the exact same words. But I teach at Rosh Hashanah, and there are a lot of skeptical kids there. Mm-hmm. And somebody said, oh, Rabbi, I don't think people are so smart. I don't think, not smart as me anyway, I don't think people are so skeptical. I think you can fool them, especially in ancient times. You can fool them easily. You can mesmerize them. So then what is it? It's my intuition against his intuition. I play the scenario through in my mind and I say, didn't. He plays it through in his mind. He says, yeah, right, lots of people, God, fire. I got it. We play it through and come to two different ends. And I don't think I can convince him by saying, I'm right and you're wrong, because I have a better intuition than you do. I don't think that's going to work. That's why I embarked on the empirical survey. The empirical survey is to say, look at human history. Do human groups make this mistake or don't they? If no known human group has ever made this mistake, then what you're saying happened is something which we have no record ever happened. Then you can't say it's probable, you have to say it's possible, and once you say it's possible, it's the end of the game. Thank you very much.